Welcome to Oregon Voters Digest, the program that brings forward the social and political issues that are important to people living here in the Pacific Northwest. And now, your host, Bruce Broussard.
Welcome again to this segment of the Oregon Voters Digest. This is 2017, folks. This is going to be an awesome year. I was just going through my archives of the Oregon Voters Digest. Do you believe it? I've got over 1,000 of these sitting in a room, 1,000 of them. I mean, I started looking at this stuff and started thinking about what about today? Nothing's changed, but we've got the history. And one of the things that we're going to do for 2017, the Voters Digest, we're going to do some very neat special kinds of things. The whole program, as far as the Voters Digest, was to educate and inform. And I've been doing that for years.
19 years.
Awesome. Isn't that something? Well, guess what? We got 2017. You know, we're just going to bring it all to date, because you always use a reference, if you will, if you're going to change anything anyway. And we were fortunate to have quite a presidential election. I mean, that was a whole different game. That was huge. Mm-hmm. Wow, wasn't it huge?
It was.
I mean, this outsider came in here and just wiped the whole deal out. And then everybody said, well, who voted for him? Well, how'd he get there? Awesome. But you know, in all due respect, what I got out of it, and I'm just kind of like doing this little preface aspect of it, and you're joining me because that's exactly the way the format we have here at the Oregon Voters Digest. You are part of what we do. That's a very, very important piece. We tend not to open the line, but we are educating you and informing you, basically, whether it be current events, whether it be historical events, an aspect of it. But at the end of the day, it's going to better our way of life, and that's the key to this whole deal. And so with that, I'm going to get right in and bring these other folks that are in there because they're very important. Like I said, we've got 4 shows a month, and we're going to have someone that's going to be chairing, sitting in this chair that I'm sitting in, that we'll have 4 individuals, and we'll do cameo shots with some other folks and whatever. But the idea is that we want to cover the city events, cover what's happening here in the city of Portland, because in all due respect, this is the living room of Oregon.
Yes.
This is the living room of Oregon. A lot of activities, things happen here. And so naturally, chairing that particular piece and taking care of that particular area will be Theresa. Here she is right here. Theresa DuPay, right here. And Don DuPay has allowed her to do that, so I had to get the okay. And so he said, Bruce, no problem. So she's the one, okay? So she's going to be covering the city piece. And as you know, she's an author. She's written books before. And in fact, she's edited some of Don's books and whatever. And Don's an author, too, in his own rights, if you will. And so we got some good. And so she's got some creative thing that's going to happen. And the so my point is that that's going to be her show. That's what she's going to do.
Once a month.
That's what she's going to do. And then naturally, another month will be we're going to talk about jobs. A guy by the name of it's really something. Sam Gillespie. Mm-hmm. Sam has been very, very much involved in the whole labor movement aspect of it. He was in Clackamas County, in Milwaukee School District, mm-hmm. and he was elected. He was an elected official there. And he spent years there in the school. But his whole forte is labor, jobs aspect of it. Very active, and he's very political and he knows the game. But he knows the bottom line of the jobs.
Yeah.
And so that's a very, very important piece. Then there's another person, a guy named I'm thinking about the young man Sorensen. Anyway, he is at the legislature in Salem.
Right.
He's working for a senator over there.
Okay.
And he's going to give us kind of like a legislative update. What's mm-hmm. going on in Salem?
Yep.
And then around the state, and then how it represents some of the stuff that's here locally. Very important. He's going to be doing a show once a month.
Okay.
So he's going to be sitting up there. So like I said, you got Sam Gillespie, you got David Sorensen. I think that's him. I mean, what do you think? The time thing on your mind is something else, isn't it? But anyway, we're going to have various people sharing whatever. And then our education side of it, too. We may pick our dear buddy, Steve Buell. Remember Steve?
Yeah.
I do.
Portland Public School. Again, that's the major school. I mean, that is the school mm-hmm. district aspect of it. I'd like to make an announcement, but I'm not going to make the announcement about the fact that he's got some things in his mind.
Okay.
I would never say anything about that, but he's thinking about maybe not running again, but I didn't say that.
because he's going to be running. He's got to run because he's got something to do. He's got to, he's been, in all due respect, he's been forming this new progressive school board.
Okay.
And that's a good thing, okay? Yeah. And so bottom line, he hasn't done that job yet, so he has to do that. So he will be sitting in this chair and be talking about the education side of it. So I think, in all due respect, we've covered quite a bit. And then there's Don sitting here, and he may be doing this maybe kind of like maybe every so often. But anyway, but he is going to talk about the whole issue of law enforcement. I mean, this happens to be the living room, if you will, of Portland. But when you think about police work and this, that, and the other, I mean, it's Portland police. I mean, they basically right at the front end of it. Don has had the history of that piece. He's written a book about that. He talked about his stories on that piece, and he's been very current. He's run for office before, and so he's been very, very active. And so the bottom line is that we're going to talk about public safety.
Sure.
And it's unfortunately that I would like to have said that the mayor would be the lead person, but unfortunately, the way the lay of the land is right now, police runs the city, yeah, politically, so to speak. It's really a sad note, but that's the way it is. But fact of the matter is, but Don is going to be talking about that. He's going to be the focal point. I'll be on the time. He'll bring on some guests, and this, that, and the other. And so we got that situation covered. And as you see, I've been donning the whole issue of veterans. That's a very key thing, both Don and I, and I'll be taking the lead on that piece.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And so that's going to be a very, we're going to be talking about veteran issues. We're going to be educating the families and people about what veterans are, benefits, if you will, and respecting the whole nine yard and what that means. And so, in fact, I'm kicking that thing off because I've been doing some things like we're visiting all of the senior citizen centers, we're visiting the old folks' homes, so to speak. And what we do is that we take the flag with us and the various flags, and we post the colors, and then we basically talk to the group as it is, and actually identify who the vets that are there aspect of it. We educate the staff about the benefits for vets.
Sure.
And we leave them a book. In fact, I had one with me here. I got the latest vet book, federal vet benefit books aspect of it. I thought I had one here, but maybe I don't have any, but anyway. But the bottom line is that that's what we're going to be doing. We're going to be basically busy. In fact, Don's going to probably be coming up there with me at times. And I got another guy named Keith, and I got another guy named Craig. He does the deal with the dogs and whatever. And we're going to be on the show and stuff like that. But it's going to be a veterans show.
Okay.
And then we're going to bring veterans on to tell their stories.
Nice.
To tell their story. Don will be able to tell his story. I'll tell my story because I've been around. But the bottom line is that we're going to tell their story because, in all due respect, that really helps out.
Sure,
it really helps out veterans across the board, and men and women, might it be, men and women. So you'll see women vets here on the show and whatever. So it's a very, very important piece, and I'm excited about the fact that I'm going to be focusing on that. Mm-hmm. And then we're going to have this historical piece.
Yeah.
So you're going to be replaying.
We're going to be replaying some of these, over 1,000 of them here. And you'd be surprised at some of the folks that I've had on these things.
You had Don in 2006 when he was
running for sheriff. we're going to play it, and then we'll talk about it.
Yeah.
You got my point? I even had Vera Katz on, and you just on and on and on.
Yeah. And you had Charlie Hales.
And Charlie Hales
with
on.
Jefferson Smith.
I even had Ted Wheeler on until he figured out who my name was. And then he wouldn't come on when we ran against him, right, Don?
Yeah.
I mean, it'd been a perfect deal for Ted to run. But this way, we'll educate him a bit. Because the guy really, he doesn't have the background. I mean, he may have the wherewithal in terms of administrative kind of a deal. But in terms of the gut work about police work and things of that nature, and building things of that nature, or owning newspapers like the Observer that I did, and right up front with you, we're all creatures of our exposure.
Right.
And we're limited. You can't do it all.
Right.
You can't do it all. So in essence, we're going to kind of help him out a little bit. And that's kind of like some of the things that we're going to be doing.
He should read a copy of Don's book.
Oh, yes. Well, he'll do the show. He'll do it. But anyway, I thought I'd open it up that way just to kind of share with the viewing audience and us and let them see the visuals of who's going to be out there talking to them and right up front with you. So that's basically what we're going to do. And so what we're going to do now for the rest of the show is that we're going to kind of maybe just give you some ideas of how we're going to be going about doing this. And in fact, why don't we start off with UT, and because the protesting is always a big thing. In fact, that's the other thing we need to let people know. I guess I got a lot of issues here of the various newspapers.
Yeah.
I've got the Mercury, the Portland Tribune, the Willamette Week, yeah. and whatever. And in all due respect, these are community newspapers.
Right. You know?
These are community newspapers, and they're free.
And they're free.
And I would recommend very strongly that you pick them up.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I mean, sure, we may have a Hispanic newspaper,
Asian
flyer.
Yeah.
but they are not community newspapers per se, mm-hmm. because mm-hmm. you got to really deal with the issues.
Yeah.
I mean, and I'm not knocking them and whatever, but they're just talking mm-hmm. to them. But this basically talks to the entire community.
Right. Right.
And it's inclusive.
Right.
There's a kind of in a more personal kind of a situation mm-hmm. and whatever. Yeah, like, for instance, here's a situation here with
outlawing bias.
Yeah, outlawing bias, efforts to curb criminal justice disparities in Oregon have failed before. Will it be different this time? And they interviewed Abel Gordley.
Yes.
Well, you know, and that's a point that I'm making about here, because she, at one point in time, she was elected leader.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
She was in the Senate mm-hmm. at one point in time. And she evolved, if you will, from Northeast Portland,
right.
from a district that the Portland Observer actually put together.
Mm-hmm.
And as a result of that, we got her and we got Margaret Carter out of that piece.
Yeah.
And again, in all due respect, I'd much rather this one. She's not a leader now.
Yeah.
You know, she should still sit up in that elected office. I mean, it's one thing, don't get me wrong, it's one thing to talk about, but you know, we need leadership, and you have to represent all the people. It's not just about being a visual talking about black yeah. issues. Don't get me wrong.
She's very accomplished, and I still have to read that. I haven't read that
article
yet.
Well, she's at Portland State.
Yeah.
Like a lot of the retired elected folks, they go over there and get themselves a check. You know what I mean? And I'm just being straight up with you about what it is. Don smiling. He understands. Hey, he was going to get one, but he wasn't the elected leader yet, see? Nor was I. So we couldn't get one. We didn't get a check. Okay. But anyway, but my point is that this is the Tribune. This is a community newspaper. And then they cover it all. And then another one. And then here's another one that's very interesting. I'm going to throw this out mm-hmm. to you. You know where I'm coming from. This is a Driving While Brown.
Portland Tribune.
You know,
yeah.
talking mm-hmm. about profiling and this, mm-hmm. that, and the other. Well, now there's another thing on the table on the current. That's where you're going to probably get into that communication piece. And Don and I probably talk about this. But the bottom line is that the whole issue of profiling, from a historical standpoint, came from the black community. That was kind of like the major issue. But the bottom line is that they didn't follow through with a solution on the black issue in Northeast Portland.
Mm-hmm.
And so now here we are coming back to the same deal aspect of it. And Don and I, we were making kind of a short talk, and then, you know, hopefully we got enough time. But we're going to talk about that, because Don was police back in those days. I mean, the work of police, for as I was concerned, back in those days, it was part of police work.
Right.
But we came up with this new word, police. We made it this way, and then we get away from that kind of a deal. But Don and I were chatting about that. But the bottom line is that Driving While Brown, when they're talking about Hispanics, well,
yeah.
you know, we all have to focus on something. But the issue of profiling should be brought back to the table in Northeast Portland, mm-hmm. where it was, and we'll talk about it that way. And hopefully we'll get Daryl Turner on the table. He happens to be a black officer,
mm-hmm.
but he also happens to be the president of Portland Police, right, as far as the ground troops
yeah.
are concerned.
Yeah.
And that'll be a good one. Then we will get Lou Frederick in, because mm-hmm. now he's introduced legislation in Salem,
mm-hmm.
but really he's talking about Northeast Portland. But he's saying this for the whole state of Oregon. And it varies.
Yeah.
You know, it varies around the state, if you will. But the bottom line, maybe we can get those two black guys to come and sit at the table.
Yeah.
They just so happen to be black, but the idea, let's talk about the solution to the problem.
Mm-hmm.
Don's got the historical yeah. piece. Derry is close. He's right there. He happens to be an African-American black.
Mm-hmm.
And you got Lou Frederick, who's a black, really. So we can kind of, let's solve the problem among the community, where a number of the, let's put it, we recognize this as where most of the blacks live.
Mm-hmm.
Things have changed, even just like the gentrification thing. But anyway, that's a good piece. And then maybe we might, I got a good friend of mine, his name is Dan Lucero. He's a good political buddy of mine, and he's Mexican. And so I think they need to spend more time talking about the whole issue of illegal.
Yeah,
the whole issue of illegal immigration aspect of it. And so we're going to just talk about that piece because that has a major impact. And so they need to spend their time getting their house in order. Mm-hmm. Just like blacks need to get spend their time getting their house in order. Because you can't go to somebody else's house talking about their issues until you got your own house together. Yeah. Fair? Okay? Yeah. Now, let's see. What's another little piece? Now, here's another situation that I thought I'd bring up. And then there's Loretta. She's on the Portland Tribune, Loretta Commissioner, yeah. Multnomah County Commissioner aspect of it. Mm-hmm. And now we've got some issues with our leadership. I mean, she's got some issues here, but the Tribune brought it out. Mm-hmm. Talked about the fact that there were some issues when she was running for office and that she was using staff to run for office. And so naturally, they basically printed the news. Well, in the community, I mean, some of the blacks in the community feels that the Tribune was lying and they were this, that, and the other, because it was a racial. No, it's not. The fact of the matter is she is a commissioner for the entire Multnomah County, so to speak, for that particular district. And it just so happened Northeast Portland is part of that. So that's something that, in all due respect, I'm glad that she's there to a certain degree, but she needed to clean her house out. If in fact that was wrong, mm-hmm. or if they did her wrong, then she needed to make sure she communicate that to the public at large, because that doesn't help the situation out at all. And then after there's my dear friend Joanne Hardesty.
Yes.
And Joanne is there. She's president of the NAACP again, which is good. I mean, she's out there. She's the head lead of probably one of the largest organizations that identify with blacks around the world. But I still think she would be better as an elected official, because as far as I'm concerned, by this time she could have been running for governor. I mean, she was an activist. I mean, back in the old days, she really did her thing. But you know, you have to stand there. You got to pick up the deal and represent all the people. And she had a chance at one point in time to get on the I think it was on Multnomah County Commissioner, as someone had left their seat or something like that. But they didn't select her. Mm-hmm. They didn't. They should have selected her, but they mm-hmm. didn't. But anyway, but she's very active. But again, the Tribune. You know, and I got the Mercury. The Mercury is fine, you know, to a certain degree, but they're number two as it relates to Willamette Week. Willamette Week is a different ball game. They got a little bit more history. Let's put it that way, okay?
Willamette Week needs your favorite people there anyway. Well, they could use some improvement. Write good articles.
Okay. So anyway, we get that, and then I've got my dear friend. Well, you know, we did a piece in 716 on Roy J. Harris, a very prominent black American, but again from Northeast Portland, and he got into this into the nonprofit arena. Mm-hmm. I mean, but that's basically. But anyway, it was a problem.
He got a little creative with the finances.
It's still an issue, and in fact, it's not over with yet.
No, it's not.
It's not over with yet.
They're still investigating.
And I'm recommending you out there right now. It's not a divide and conquer routine. You need to Google his name with the Portland Tribune. That's all you have to do. You Google his name at the Portland Tribune, and you can get all the background material mm-hmm. about what we're talking about. Because it would take mm-hmm. us 2 or 3 hours to do that piece. And then at the same time, you can Google the Oregon Voters Digest, and you can see the shows that I had with a gentleman by the name of Baruti Archery, who brought this to the table initially. Mm-hmm. And you can see all of the background material. And then I would, again, same thing with Roy J. If it was wrong, then educate the people and tell them blah, 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 whatever. But the bottom line, it's an issue, and it's not over with yet. And we're going to make sure we keep stay on top of that peace aspect of it. We got that one. What else did we do anything else?
There was a story in the Tribune. Three die of hypothermia.
Oh, what was that? Yes.
And actually, it was a total of four.
Yes.
And I'll be interviewing next week. I'll be interviewing Christine Van Order about that.
Here we go. Right there.
She wants to talk about the three issues.
Three die. Okay, yeah, good. That'll be very interesting. And, you know, and that's a very interesting piece too. And by the way, you notice how we're having this chat. We suggest that you do the same thing at home, too, by the way. Get around the table. Get a copy of the Tribune and this, that, and the other, and just go through it.
Yeah.
Get a copy of the Willamette Week and go through it. Now, for those of us, if you are saying, well, gee, what about our black newspapers and our Hispanic newspapers and our Asian newspapers? If you got the time, you can read them. But in all due respect, they're really not community newspapers. When I say community, I'm talking totally diverse.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's not a black community, it's not a white community, it's not a brown community. No. It's just red-blooded Americans, all of us, all in one pot. Everybody's bleeding red, I think, mm-hmm. right?
Yeah.
But the bottom line is not taking anything away from those newspapers.
Yeah.
But we're going to need community newspapers that people can have access to. Because when you
start, cover all the bases aspect
of it, and when I start thinking about our piece, we're a community medium aspect of it. You can get that piece, but unfortunately, sometimes you have to buy a Comcast to get it. And the same, you know what I'm saying?
YouTube. We're putting it on YouTube. Well,
YouTube is good.
We're making it available.
Yeah, this by the way, all the shows here are going to be on YouTube for the Voters Digest, yep. which is good. So, but the fact of the matter is, you know, Comcast, you got to buy it, so you're limited. But with the Tribune, again, I'm talking about Oregon.
Mm-hmm.
I'm talking about the Oregonian, too. Let's not forget the Oregonian, because that's the only statewide newspaper. Right.
There it is.
It's gotten
rather puny.
It really is. I'm about the size of the Sears Roebuck catalog, wouldn't it?
Exactly. Looks like the Nickelodeon.
You know what I'm saying? It's a very interesting piece. I saw an interesting article about my dear friend Earl Blumenauer. I mean, here's a guy who's like an icon here in this area, but never does his job. You know, that's another thing. And hopefully Earl will come to the show. Mm-hmm. He needs to recognize that he's an employee of the people.
Yeah.
Because this is a government of the people, by the people, and for the people. And too often elected officials tend to forget that.
Yeah.
They think that they're the God. They're not. They're employees. What did they forget that, Don?
They get their first paycheck.
Is that what it is?
Yeah.
Oh, gee. Is that what it is?
Yeah.
But I'm kind of...
get that paycheck.
You know, and as far as the city council is concerned, I think it's a good idea. They got this new young lady, and in all due respect, there was an activist activist community that got her out of there.
Mm-hmm.
Now she's sitting there, and she's got some platforms initially.
Are you talking about Chloe Udalen?
Chloe, yeah.
And Chloe Udalen.
Yeah, and as far as I'm concerned, hey, she's there. She's an elected official. She's got something to say. And I just say, focus on your platform.
Yeah.
I mean, don't get me wrong. The other four need to be coming on board anyway.
I think she has some good ideas. She could learn to communicate a little more smoothly with the other council members. She's in very good company. And so there's been some question as to her ability to communicate well with others. But I think she has some good ideas. Oh. Well,
she's opened up the door.
Yeah.
You know, in all due respect, she's opening up the door because the rest of them wasn't communicating to you anyway.
Yeah.
Unless you either gave them some big contributions or something like that. You know what I'm saying? Because, you know, we just went through that experience running for mayor.
That's the trouble with the city council is they don't play well with others.
They don't communicate. Yeah. I mean, that's why we get in trouble with these folks on their homeless piece, people dying in this, that, and the other. Or the snow. Where the mayor didn't know what the heck he was doing, you know? And now all of a sudden we got it. So my point is that we need to start communicating.
Yeah.
And it's going to take all of us working together.
Mm-hmm.
But make sure it's about our house first.
Yeah.
And I say, so we got the national piece, but in all due respect, that's the national piece.
Mm-hmm.
We got issues in Oregon. We got issues in Portland, Oregon.
Mm-hmm.
And we got issues in police and this, that, and the other. So we need to take care of our own house first.
Mm-hmm.
And everybody join, right? Fair?
Right.
Okay. So with that, now I'm going to let you guys come in. I mean, I've taken almost 30 minutes on my front end. Don, give us a little piece about the police thing. I mean, like the profiling. Give them an example. Let's talk about an example of you were in the police department at one point in time. When did that come up about police profiling?
I don't remember when they started complaining about it.
In the 80s.
Probably in the 80s.
Yeah.
Well, I never referred to it as profiling when I was a street cop.
What was it? What did you call it?
Doing your job.
Mm-hmm.
That's what I call it, doing my job, you know.
Well, racial profiling does exist, but
I'm sure it does.
You have a different perspective because there's a question about, you know, what's abusive racial profiling, pulling a man over because he's in a really nice car and he's black in the middle of the day, or pulling a black man over in a really nice car at 3 a.m.
Okay.
And so Don has a different perspective about it, but it's important to remember that, you know, racial profiling does exist.
So how do we solve it? I mean, that's the other thing. I mean, you make the statement, but how do we solve the problem? That's what we are right now.
I don't know. I mean, see, that's the
that's
issue.
I'm asking Don. I'm saying, Don, how do we deal with it, Don?
I don't think there is a solution to what you're going to call profiling because policemen are always going to do their job. And someone, it's not so much as, are you black and driving a nice car, or are you Mexican and driving a nice car? It's what's unusual about you.
Mm-hmm.
That's what gets the policeman's attention. And the reason I say that is because I was profiled by a Multnomah County deputy sheriff. I was driving a late model Cadillac, a nice looking car with fancy wheels. It had out-of-state license plates on it. It was after dark, and it was I had a black man sitting in the front seat with me. The deputy stopped me, and he stopped me to see who I was, what I was doing at night after dark in his car. I couldn't fault the man. He was doing his job. He didn't know who I was, where I came from. Do your job. I had no problem with it.
What about white profiling? Is there such thing as a white profiling?
Well, I don't know. Well, like I said, it's not whether I was white or not. It's the fact that I was unusual. It's the unusual aspect of what I was doing and driving.
There's examples of bad racial profiling. I mean, I know of a PSU professor. His name is Michael Smith. He was one of my former professors. He's black.
Okay.
He's black.
Okay.
And he gets pulled over once a month in the city of Beaverton, Oregon, because he has a nice car, because he has dreadlocks, because he's black. They know who he is. I mean, every Beaverton police officer has pulled this guy over at one time or another, and they still do it. They know who he is. He's a professor at PSU, and yet they continue to pull him
over. Why can't he take him to court? I mean, that's how you can solve some of that problem.
I don't know, but that's an example of really of just blatant racial profiling. Almost, you could consider it harassment too. But like what Don said is right. Don's right about what he said too, but then you have instances where black people in the middle of the day are driving a really nice car and they get pulled over repeatedly, maybe by the same officer. That's racial profiling. That's abusive racial profiling.
That's poor supervision. That goes to the supervisor. If your sergeant is letting you get away with that, then that's a problem. You shouldn't be doing it.
So how would one solve something like that? Okay, if the sergeant followed up on that piece, right?
If I'm your sergeant, I'm going to know what you're doing.
Okay. Then what happens to that person?
And then if you're not,
lose pay.
And then if you're you're liable to lose your district
and lose your job.
You might get on the desk for a while.
Okay. What about the job?
I don't know if I can fire you.
Can you get the pocketbook?
No, I don't think we can do that because they're civil service.
Civil service
can do no wrong.
Who's that?
They can practically do no wrong.
Police officers.
Okay. But you can certainly make it difficult for them if they don't follow the rules. And if I'm your boss, you follow my rules.
Also,
but then on the other hand, what's a cop supposed to do if he's working a black district and he's working at night and he stops black people in the middle of the night and he's accused of harassing people? Most of that is nonsense, because if you work a black district like I did, I'm only going to be stopping black people, and that's my job, is to find out who's in the neighborhood, what's going on, what you're doing.
But do you stop white people in the same area?
Yes.
Okay.
Because they very seldom came to the Albina district, and if they did, then I wanted to know,
that was your
what
district.
Are you doing here?
That was your area. Okay.
That was my, what are you doing here? Because you're going to get in trouble here.
The issue also is you were a police officer in the 60s
this was a
and
long
the 70s,
time ago,
so it was a very long time ago.
Yeah.
Now, the question is, are police officers racially profiling black people in diverse areas, where in the Northeast Portland areas where there are black and white and Hispanic and Asian people? Are they singling them out? That's the question. And if they are, then they should be educated by their sergeants or their supervisors to get to know who those people are, so that if they see them in the future, you know, they don't just automatically pull them over for the fifth or sixth time in a 3-month period.
Also, don't drive with the lights out. Don't drive with your license plate light burn out. Don't drive with a broken tail light. I mean, eliminate all the reasons that I might stop you because I want to see who.
But that's anywhere.
That's anywhere.
Okay,
anybody.
Okay.
Don't give the police a reason to stop you. Fix your lights.
Now, one
get
of the
your driver's
things,
license.
When, you think, when one says racial profile, normally they tend to identify black folks. Okay. Yeah. Now I'm saying, okay, fine. If they identify black folks, and we've got a lot of history about race, if you will. We've gone through a lot of that era aspect of it. But then there was a time, and I was part of that process, of, quote, we need to get more black officers on the police department.
Yeah. Well.
And I remember Berna Plummer and a number of other folks would go out and, hey, we went down to City Hall, we did everything. That's where the Harry Jacksons of the world came out, and the Warrens, and mm-hmm. and I can know the federal marshal that Berna was really actively trying to get in and whatever. And those folks got in there, and the whole purpose was to react to that, get more officers on the street who happened to have been black. Mm-hmm. But when they got them on, they moved them out. What did they do? Now they did have officers. I mean, I think about Dick Bogle at one point in time was an officer. You had him.
In the 60s, when I joined the police department, I didn't know there were any black people on the bureau. When I joined the bureau, I found out, there's 7 or 8 of them, but you can't see them.
Mm-hmm.
They work the jail. They work radio at night. They work graveyard shift in Selwood. Mm-hmm. They were never seen by white people.
Interesting. Hold your point there. We're going to take a short break, and I want you to follow up on the same deal. Folks, we'll be right back. And hope it take your time out, get you some tea, get some coffee, and get back to the table. Be right back.
You are watching Oregon Voters Digest. This program can be seen again on these channels on these dates and times. Tell a friend.
Okay, welcome back, folks. You're back here. This is the 2017. The new. We're going to communicate, and we're going to inform, and we're going to have fun doing it. And we're going to quote. I don't want to use his brand. He might pick me up. We're going to make Oregon great again.
Yeah. Well, we were talking about black police officers.
Yeah, black police officers.
Whether or not
right.
they were visible.
Right.
And I'm thinking specifically of the Duke brothers.
Right.
They were came on during after the war.
Tall, good looking,
tall, good looking,
educated.
Smart guys.
Yeah.
They both became police officers.
Were there three?
There were three of them.
Portland police officers.
Yeah, Portland police officers. One of them quit.
Yeah.
So the two were made. They were both working graveyard shift on East Precinct when I worked graveyard.
Right in Northeast Portland.
Next to Northeast Portland. But they were assigned to Selwood.
They what?
They were assigned to Selwood.
Selwood?
Selwood.
Well, but Northeast is right here.
The all-white, I was the guy in the all-black
You
district.
Were the only one.
And the all-white, all-black guys were assigned to the white district.
Were they arresting white folks?
Yeah. Well, yeah.
Really?
Oh, yeah.
Big time?
Yeah,
they hitting them upside the head and everything?
They were good policemen.
They were hitting them upside the head and stuff?
I don't know
but
about that.
There were.
They were good policemen.
I said, were they hitting them upside the head?
I don't know.
Well, you were in the police department. You should have known.
Yeah, well, I know they were good guys.
There were white police officers at the time that did refuse to work with them because they were black. But
really?
Don only knew
that was
of
before
them.
I came on.
Okay.
Before you came on.
Okay.
That was before. There was nobody at East
was Bogle there? Was Bogle there when you got there?
Yes.
Bogle.
Yeah, he was.
Dick Bogle.
Bogle showed up.
He showed up.
Bogle, first time I
before
saw Bogle,
you after.
I was introduced to him.
Okay.
He was wearing a black leather jacket, and he was undercover in some deal.
Okay.
And they introduced me to him. This is Dick Bogle. He's a cop.
Right, right, right. Former commissioner, too, by the way.
Yeah,
City
former,
Council commissioner.
Yeah.
You know, the other thing about, now, we made that effort to get more blacks on the Port Police Department.
Yeah.
But the whole purpose was, one of the main things, the solution, was the whole idea of profiling. Get more blacks involved in Northeast Portland, therefore making sure that they were assigned different areas.
Yeah.
Because at the time they were talking about giving them homes, providing
right.
housing and this, that,
for
and other.
In the
other. It was an awesome concept. And the idea of getting the Jackson types and folks who were familiar with the area, then they knew the area, they knew the people. And it was great.
It was a good idea.
Yeah, and Harry Jackson did a heck of a job. He could ride in the car by himself. He knew everybody on the street, almost mm-hmm. just like yourself, so to speak. And mm-hmm. it was not an issue. We didn't have a major problem with prostitution. By the way, prostitution will always be here. I mean, get it on Facebook now.
Right.
I hate to put it that way, but
it's
that's
different now,
but that's the real
it?
World. It's different.
Yes.
It's gotten to be more business-wise, okay? But the fact of the matter is, that was a solution. But then all of a sudden, they're not there anymore. You know, there was only one Harry. And I remember the Warrens and this, that, and the other.
We have.
Then all of a sudden, they were just kind of like dispersed. And then there were the new guys that came on. They weren't recruiting in the Portland metropolitan area anymore. Yeah. And then they came up with the degree thing. You had to have the degree, mm-hmm. you know what I mean? But the bottom line, when you start thinking about people working on the streets, you want the everyday kind of a person anyway, so to speak. That's a different ballgame when you get into the degree deal, because just a certain degree, it's about the money.
For a while, they wanted people, I think the requirement was a two-year degree, and then it became a four-year degree, which became problematic because not everyone who's going to apply to be a police officer has a four-year degree. Now, I think it's back to a two-year degree. I'm not really positive, yeah. but a better educated cop makes a better cop.
Really?
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
How about just a good common sense one?
Well, you have to have both.
Yeah,
really.
Yeah.
But that's the lacking thing sometimes. You know, sometimes yes. you can just say common sense. I mean,
they don't teach common sense in college.
Yeah, that's
but you
true.
See, but Don, just like yourself, even if they could put a uniform on you today, they could put a uniform on me today.
Yeah.
They could strap me up with a weapon. I've been in the Marine Corps or whatever. I'm very familiar with weapons, whatever. And you and I, with no problem, could go right in the middle of any homeless, any negative camp whatsoever, and we talk to them about it. We'd know what to do, when to do. My point is that we communicate the fact that we are deterrent, that you've done something wrong, and we're asking you something. But now, if you go beyond that point, we either take the slapstick or whatever, do that kind of thing, whatever.
I wouldn't want Don to get potentially hurt.
What?
Well,
he's 80.
What? Trust me, we would not get hurt.
I know what you're saying.
You know what I'm saying, buddy? Huh?
Yeah.
Okay, but no, but I'm
we
not,
could be advisors.
Yeah, but my point is that. You know, that's what you need, communication.
Yeah.
You know, because I mean, look, when we ran for office, remember that? We was walking around, I was talking to homeless, I was talking mm-hmm. to people in the corners. I'm talking about diehard areas and this, that, and the other. That was not an issue. I didn't have an issue.
But there are problems with the police department that need to be fixed. They need to be fixed now. They're over specialized. It's not that we don't have. We don't have enough policemen, but the ones we do have aren't being properly employed.
There's another
aspect.
There's
too many of them specialized.
There's another thing Don and I were talking about the other day. When Don was a police officer, to be a veteran officer, you had to be on the street for 5 years.
Mm.
Now, they say a veteran officer can...
they call them veterans.
After 3 years, I don't agree with that at all.
And
neither
does
Don.
They just don't
They're
know
still
the
a rookie.
Your probation is a year and a half.
Right. Yeah.
And if 3 years, you got a year and a half of your own.
Yeah.
You're not a veteran.
Yeah.
No.
You're a newbie.
Not at all.
Yeah.
Don was on for the streets for 6 years.
You need that hash mark.
Yeah. yeah. He was
Comes
on the streets for 6 years before he was able to apply for detective, and he was promoted to detective. But he was a veteran after 6 years. Now you've got this police officer recently, Officer Kearney, who's been on the force for 6 years. Mm. And he had been an officer for 3 years, and he killed a man, and he killed...
Just recently, right?
Right, yeah. Just recently, and he killed the young black man who was 17 and shot him multiple times in the back. He's only been an officer for 6 years.
And where is that
and
right
two,
now?
And two people are dead.
Yeah, that's a good example. Again, we're talking about a solution. Okay, now we got to... Yeah, that's an issue.
It
people
is
see
an
that
issue.
As an issue. So what do we do about something like that,
I
Don?
Think they should go back to 5 years.
Okay.
A police officer's not a veteran when he's been an officer for 3 years.
Okay.
He's still new to the profession. I think they should go back to, you know, once again, the old way. They should be considered a veteran only after 5 years to 6 years of time on the street.
They promote too quickly, too.
Yeah, they do. It's
but
ridiculous.
But then the recruiting aspect of it, that's I'm very interested. I mean, you got to have more of the Harry Jackson. They don't do that anymore.
They're not recruiting
They're not
correctly.
Recruiting correctly.
No,
you know what I'm saying?
Not.
They're not recruiters.
No.
You know, they're recruiting PERS.
Yeah.
I mean, people are jumping up there with the money.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying? And because they can qualify themselves because they got degrees and this, that, and the other. But they're not necessarily... police officers.
Well, like Don said in his book, and we've discussed this too, he did say it's really, really a stringent process. And I suppose that's a good thing. In the past, I've been critical of the fact that they're really tough.
Yeah.
It's really hard to be accepted with Portland Police Bureau, but I think maybe they really do need an empty slate.
Yeah.
Because
yeah.
they need people that they can train, that they will hope will take the training and not become rogues and go out on their own and do bad things.
Mm-hmm. What about the training component? What about some of the old guys? Are the old guys doing the training? Don, as you
I
know,
don't know. It's completely
who,
different
who's
now.
Who's doing the training now?
Well, I don't know. They have a statewide academy down in Monmouth, Oregon, which... I don't think it's a very good idea.
Mm-hmm.
I think that Portland police ought to be trained here in Portland.
I think they have a new facility here in Portland.
I don't know.
And what about most of these officers? Are they living in the Portland metropolitan area?
Probably not.
Well, I mean,
probably not.
And that's it makes more sense
that if they did it, let them drive their cars home. That's like a deterrent. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? Because if you park your car, that kind of a deal. But then it's got to be such a mess nowadays that there's sort of a promotional kind of a mindset that, you know, if you now you can shoot the person with the uniform. A lot of folks don't are very cautious. You know, from the standpoint where they walk in on someone or this, that, and the other, they gotta pull the gun or hold that gun or whatever. And you get someone that's, you know, i.e. that's drunk or something like that. They may do this switch, this, that, and the other, and then all of a sudden, somebody's shot.
There is a public perception that police officers nationwide and in Portland shoot too quickly and ask questions later.
Wow.
And if this young man, Quanice, was shot, I heard he was shot 12 times in the back.
12 times.
That's what I heard, but I'm not standing by that because I just heard it on public, social media. But if that is true, that's
The commanding officer of the Portland Police Department is the mayor.
The mayor.
Yeah. The chief is that just really the administrative arm of the deal. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah. And that's another thing. You know, yeah. I was watching the news the other day. I was watching a video. I think it was on Cameron Witten's Facebook because he's been doing a lot of live streaming lately. And
Cameron's a local young man. I guess he's a director of community stuff.
Know Your City, I think. But he's wonderful. Cameron is a wonderful idealist, and he's committed and dedicated, and I have so much respect for him. So does Don. We just both think he's terrific.
Got to run for office, though.
He really has a wonderful future, and he's very beloved in Portland. But he had a video on, and I was watching it, and my gosh, I don't think it was the peaceful protesters. I think it was probably more like the troublemakers and the anarchists. The terrible things they were saying to the police officers, and I think that's an issue. The public and local citizens think that the police just decide to come out on their own accord. Yeah. The police officers that are on the street that's their job. They're told by their sergeants there's a command structure, and it starts with the mayor and then the chief of police.
Right.
So the cops on the street are just... they're just the police officers on the street. They don't decide to just go out there and be at a protest and make people feel afraid or whatever. They're doing their job.
Well, their support base is the union. I mean, they use that union, i.e. Platform, as a way of saying, at least I have someone that's looking out for my back, so to speak.
But they're ordered to be there. It's part of their job. And then
should be by the mayor.
Yeah. And it's discouraging to see certain protesters just saying the horrible, typically... you know, the historically abusive things they say and just calling them names. And it's so ignorant because it's not like they're coming out. They just decided, hey, I'll just go out to this protest today. They've been ordered to be there. They're doing their job. They're obeying orders.
But then how do we, again, we talked about this before when we were running for mayor, remember? Mm-hmm. We said, okay, fine. You want to protest? Hey, First Amendment right, freedom of speech, right? You got me? But the bottom line is that we need to know what you're wanting to protest for. Yeah. You need to educate the people as a whole, if you will, because you got, whether it be downtown or anywhere, and maybe the process could be the city council is sitting there. They meet every Wednesday, okay? And whoever the person who want to initiate the protest would go before the council, fill out the form and say, this is what we want to protest on. Talk about it. TV's there, the whole nine yards.
The other issue is sometimes these gatherings are very organic and they're like almost kind of like a flash mob. Not quite, but
can't do that.
I understand that. But, you know, there was a candlelight vigil for Quanice, for the young man Quanice.
Okay.
And that's people gathered. And so you have this consistent dynamic of peaceful protesters wanting to get together and do something meaningful, like a candlelight vigil or what have you, and then other protesters, anarchists, troublemakers, causing trouble.
But let's define, in all due respect, let's define those folks. The fact of the matter is, you got some people who understand the issue. They're well read about the issue.
Yeah.
And then there are some people who didn't read the paper and didn't look at the TV piece. All they know, they got the word that somebody got shot 11 times in the back. Mm-hmm. And he was a black person. Mm-hmm. And, you know, and things have happened to me, right? Mm-hmm. And I'm not going to come in there trying to be a nice guy. When I see that uniform, my point is that I've got to make a statement. So some way, shape, or form, we got to educate that person. But at the same time, we got to make sure that we solve that problem on that front end. That person who shot that young man 11 times in the back.
12. That's what I heard.
That needs to be solved one way or the other
early on, that Don said, the sergeant. Mm-hmm. You go in there, do the investigative work mm-hmm. aspect of it, and say, okay, fine, this is why this happened. I'm not going to give the guy 2 months leave. You know what I'm saying?
Well, it'll be more than it. You know, they're investigating it right now, and that's the other thing. The investigation's not even over. I mean, we don't really know what happened.
Well, now, didn't they just pass some kind of a ruling or something that you just can't just take off and go on vacation for a month or two?
I think the rule wasn't the ruling. It was the 48-hour rule. But guess what?
Is he back on force now?
He's on administrative leave, but it. You know, he didn't make us. I mean, nobody's really.
But here we are having a discussion. Mm-hmm. When, in all due respect, our mayor, we elected that person. You know, he's our lead person. He's got to communicate to the people across the board, even if it's calling a press conference mm-hmm. and letting the people know what happened. And
but
why.
They don't know what happened because the investigation's still ongoing.
Yeah, but still, as the mayor,
yeah.
I want to hear from you. Yeah. Saying, yeah. Hey, look, it's ongoing, and here's an update on this investigation aspect of it. This is what the person is doing.
You know, my feeling is Ted Wheeler's probably being advised by Marshman, by the chief of police, to wait for a while. But I agree. I mean, he should make a statement. I think, you know, Wheeler's done a pretty good job. He's so new to the job. Already people are saying he's a lame duck mayor and comparing him to Charlie Hales. A couple people I saw on Facebook, which I think is kind of ridiculous because he's only been mayor for, you know, a couple months. I mean,
yeah, but he made some mistakes early on. I mean, like mm-hmm. I said, here's Don. I mean, we were out there. Yeah. I mean, here's Don with his kind of a background and with my background whatsoever.
Yeah.
The guy wouldn't even come on the show.
I know.
I mean, but we called his office. We did everything we could. We talked to his staff. The man wouldn't even have the respect. I went to an event where he was there,
mm-hmm.
and I had my cover on with my Marine Corps cover, the whole, with my jacket. You know the other jacket that I had? The guy didn't even come over to say hi. And I think I was the only black man in the whole crowd. I mean, not that I was afraid of anything, but I was just kind of observing him to see whether or not he would at least come, because he came on the show once before.
This is the thing about Wheeler. Wheeler has a whole group of people with the Portland Police Bureau currently employed. These are experts in their field. He's going to rely on them. He's not going to talk to some old guy was a cop in the 60s.
No, I ain't buying that. No. He got elected because he's supposed to be taking the lead. That's the key.
Yeah,
I don't want to hear this other business about let's be timid. No, he was elected. He mm-hmm. opted to run for office.
Mm-hmm.
Trust me.
Mm-hmm.
Don knows this and I know this.
Mm-hmm.
If we were elected to this, trust me, you would be getting some results.
Yeah.
Fair?
Yeah. Yeah.
I made it very clear who was going to be calling his job. But at the end of the day, it was going to be me. Right,
yeah.
Don?
Yeah.
Wheeler does need some additional perspective, particularly with regard to law enforcement.
But my point is that we've had that history.
Yeah.
He should have
known
that when he put his name down and said, I want to run for mayor of the city of Portland. Mm-hmm. We had issues.
Mm-hmm.
And then whoever files to run for office should be responsible.
I know.
Maybe we need to vet that deal. Maybe we check that form out to find out, do you have the necessary background to run for any office for that matter?
I think there should be, like, more rules, just like you're saying, because I don't know. I mean, is it really worth the city's time to have some, you know, I guess it's not constitutional, but you do hear of people running for office and they don't have the background.
Yeah.
They don't have any real ideas or any issues created or that they can even discuss.
Yeah.
And so, I definitely kind of.
And, you know, in all due respect, I'm thinking about one incident about Wapato. Remember, you did the Wapato deal. Mm-hmm. And yet here's a guy at one point in time was the commission chair of Multnomah County.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And here we are in Portland. He's running for office. We're talking about Wapato and the homeless and this, that, and the other. We're making the point about picking everybody up,
mm-hmm.
take them down to Wapato, and process them to find out who's on the street.
Mm-hmm.
Well, here's a guy that's already, he's been the chair. Well, what in the hell was he doing the 4 years he was at? Wapato was there then.
Mm-hmm.
Why did he take the thing by the handle then, get involved in the process, get together with Kefauri and, you know, and the mayor, Charlie Hill, and say, look, we need to put this piece together. I think it's a good idea. It's obviously, we were qualified. They mm-hmm. didn't say we couldn't run.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. I still don't know what the issue with Wapato is. It's like this.
No,
wants to touch it.
No, it's 600 beds. Now, the point is, the people who don't want to touch it are the folks who don't know what the hell they're doing.
And Loretta Smith wrote a commentary a couple months ago about
that.
It.
I remember that.
You know, and it's
they didn't want to touch it.
Yeah, I still cannot figure out why it's such.
But it's our money.
Yeah.
Also, Wheeler was in charge of basically in charge of the sheriff's office during that time period too, because they fund the sheriff's office.
Yes.
So he's already had a chance at running a police department.
Yes.
You know, so what's he going to do now?
Yeah, what's he going to do?
I don't know.
So well, my point is that what he could do to start off with, he could come on the show and sit down and have I don't want to have a cup of coffee with me at a coffee shop.
I want
eyeball to eyeball to let the public see it.
Yeah.
And you and I asking him questions. And we're helping him out. We're not about beating him up. The fact of the matter is he's going to need some help. And when I look at the people that are around him, I know there's some political appointments, but they don't have any background.
Yeah.
I mean, a good example of that is he hired this young, I saw this one article about this young African-American that he hired, one of the chief of staff.
Yeah.
And then there he was, he's in trouble.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah, he was in trouble. He was in the Oregonian, and what he had done, he said he messed up. Really giving him the, giving him some names to piss and whatever. This one young lady was pregnant, and she was talking about.
Oh yeah.
Remember that piece aspect of it?
Yeah.
And he screwed up, and they did the whole deal on him aspect of it. Well, the fact of it, I don't even know who the man is. In fact, we even asked to see whether or not he could come on the show.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And you know, hiring a black for who? Where, what black community he's talking about? I know he doesn't represent me.
Yeah, I remember that. Yeah.
You know what I mean? But I'm just saying. But here's this guy. He's totally out there by himself. When I got out of the article, what he was doing, what he was told.
Mm-hmm.
You got me?
Yeah.
And then to a certain degree, maybe somebody's trying to get rid of him.
Mm-hmm.
You get me?
Yeah.
And then somebody else stepped in. That's the same thing they did with Baruti Aburi, because he would have been a heck of a commissioner, a liaison, if you will, for Charlie Hill to the police department. But they did that politics on him and got rid of him.
Mm-hmm.
Guys are solid. He's solid as a rock. But now here's this guy here. What's he going to do?
Mm-hmm.
So he needs to look at, in fact, my first shot was that I knew Lou had ran up there, and I knew at one point in time that who am I thinking about, the NAACP, what's that?
Hardesty?
Yeah, Hardesty. She went up there to try to see whether or not she could work for him. He should have hired her.
Mm-hmm.
He should have hired her.
Yeah.
He could have hired Lou Frederick. Lou's not doing anything down in Salem. Mm-hmm. He needs to do something here in Northeast Portland, if you will. It's called what do you call that? This whole business about the housing deal over there and gentrification.
Yeah, yeah.
I mean,
yeah.
Give me a break. Gentrification. What are you doing, Lou? What are you doing, Earl?
Yeah.
What are you doing, Ron? You know, and people just talk as if it's gentrification. Let's get this pot of money to build four houses, and we're going to give it to four people out of the area.
I was on social media the other day, and Fred was talking about gentrification and rent control.
Yeah.
He was bringing up some really good points about the fact that a lot of these buildings are governed by white people.
Yeah.
And so it's supposed to provide housing for people of color.
Yeah.
And then guess what?
Yeah.
They pick and choose their family members and their friends.
Oh, yeah.
And then it ends up all white.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
But my point is that's the way it is.
Yeah.
Now, we need to clean it up.
That needs to change.
We need to change.
Yeah.
And we need leadership.
Yeah.
We need leadership. I'm not talking about just somebody talking about race.
Mm-hmm.
I'm talking about you running for office if you got some background and you get elected to office of leadership. And I'm talking about a mayor that understands. When he says gentrification, he also comes up with a solution to that piece.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Because guess who's doling out the money?
Mm-hmm.
His office.
Right.
Those federal dollars are coming in. Where are the monies going to?
You
understand what I'm saying? You got me?
Yeah.
And I'm not bringing up the Roy J piece right up, but with Roy J, he was doing things about trying to get these guys, ex-offenders, i.e. black, and getting them back so they can work and find a place to live and this, that, and the other. But then you ask yourself, the first thing I ask, well, wait a minute, something's wrong with that picture. Because before they get out the institution, they are assigned a probation officer.
Yes.
And that probation officer, that's that job, to sit down with them and prepare them before they leave. And they got a direct link with these people until they get back into the deal. So why would they have a separate entity? So I'm not, so when I think about Roy, I'm thinking about the people who signed the check.
Right.
Who gave him the money.
Yeah.
What was the reason behind that deal?
Mm-hmm.
Did they have a white deal?
Mm-hmm.
Did they have an Asian deal there?
Mm-hmm.
See what I'm saying? So my point is that we need to talk about solutions.
Yeah, we do.
See?
And people need to be held accountable. Don and I were driving the other day, driving home, and we were in downtown Portland, and he's gotten so good at avoiding the potholes in the street.
Oh,
that he's like this. He's like a snake on a mission.
Gee.
He's like weaving in and out just to avoid, because we have a Jeep.
Gee.
The potholes in downtown Portland are terrible.
Oh, gee.
And we were talking about that last
Where'd the money go?
Let me give you a good example. What's going on?
Let me give you a good example. I was a contractor, too. Back in the old days, you had good work. You had good work. I mean, they had to do the work. I mean, that pavement material was solid enough that it was there. But today, again, under that same Fontrain, in all due respect, like the Wheeler part, he's got political appointment. You point these people to transportation and things of that nature. But guess what? They don't know the contract. The contract say, no, hell, I'm going to be there to have some more potholes here next year.
Yeah.
And so it's about the money. So someone needs to know what the hell they're doing.
Yeah.
That's why you got all that. You can see where what it's doing is separating itself from the last layer, right?
Mm-hmm.
You seen that?
Yeah.
That's
yeah.
why. It's the material they're using.
Yeah.
And no one makes cover their butts on the contract.
Mm-hmm.
Say,
mm-hmm.
by the way, this has to be guaranteed for 2 years or three years.
It ain't working very long.
Yeah. Okay. Well, folks, are you getting the gist here? That's going to be the new Oregon Voters Digest for 2017. We're going to be hard-hitting. We're going to talk about the issues, but we're going to talk about solutions. And we're going to try to bring the people on who are supposed to be the solutionaries.
Yeah.
We're the solutionees, because we're paying for this stuff.
Well, you they come want... on, and we won't beat them up.
We'll Teresa's going to keep that deal.
Yeah.
She's a city person.
Yeah.
And we may want to recommend some stuff to her, but the fact she makes the last decision, you know, man, she's going to be nice. We may get on. We may open up the line, and you'll get out. We'll talk to her about that way aspect of it. But anyway, this has been very enjoyable.
Yeah.
And so, you know, so hopefully we're okay now, right?
Yeah.
And folks out there,
good to be back.
Here it is. We're back here. And I want to say a dear friend, my dear friend, O.B. Hill. I mean, an icon in the community, in the Portland area aspect of it. I mean, he just passed away, O.B. Hill. Very neat guy, I tell you. Well, take care, my buddy, O.B., okay? But anyway, I got a historical piece on O.B., and I'm going to be doing that in a future deal. I'm going to put O.B. on, okay?
Okay.
But then, this is where we are at this point in time, and thank you for being with us. We really appreciate that, and for you'll join us, and tell your friends. And like I said, you can go on YouTube, hit OVD, Oregon Voters Digest, and you'll get the piece, okay? So with that, thank you very much. We enjoy you. We'll see you next week. No, Teresa will be here next week.
Teresa.
In living color. Take care. Have a good one.